Hi guys, today I have a helper in my lectures. I have Joe sitting behind me, sunning himself in the window, and who knows, sometimes he gets kind of talkative and he might add his opinion to today's lecture. There he is, always with an opinion. Good boy. Okay, go back to sleep. All right, so today's lecture is going to be on the Early Palaeozoic. Let's let things get focused in, and then we'll... All right, so we have now left the Precambrian. We finished going over the Hadean, Archean, and Proterozoic. We're now in the Phanerozoic. A Phanerozoic includes three main eras, the Paleozoic, Mesozoic, and Cenozoic. And today's journey is going to be in the Early Palaeozoic, which are three time periods, the Cambrian, Ordovician, and Silurian, which accounts for about 122 million years of Earth's history. So again, we're going to come to this time scale. All of that is the Precambrian, right? That's where Earth began, and we've already gone over all of that time period. Now we're entering this time, the Phanerozoic. In this Paleozoic, that's all of that. Today we're going to be in the Cambrian, Ordovician, and Silurian. And so a few things to look at in this time period. Right around the Proterozoic-Cambrian boundary, there was a possible short-lived supercontinent. And this is one of these things that I've mentioned before in geology, there's often some debate about stuff. And this is one of these things that is debated somewhat. And so there was this possible supercontinent of Panoitia that assembled in the very late Proterozoic and broke up in the early Paleozoic. And the people who believe this existed, and like I said, there is some good evidence that it existed, reconstructed basically like this. And so we would have had, where the hell is North America? Laurentia is somewhere in here. No, right here. There's Laurentia, and I think that might be South America, but anyway, you don't need to know that. So let's move on to the more interesting things. So after this possible supercontinent broke up, we end up with a few major continental landmasses at this time. We have Laurentia, which is North America. We have Baltica, which is the core of Europe. We have Siberia, that's Siberia, right? Much of Asia. There's China, and then there's Gondwana. Gondwana is the basically the southern continents. So Gondwana consists of India, Africa, South America, and Antarctica and Australia. So all of those are still stuck into this fairly large continental mass. So that's what we're seeing right here. This big mass right here, that's Gondwana. And then that is Laurentia. That is Baltica, and I believe that one is China right there. So some terms to remember as we go through this early Paleozoic history. Remember the craton, when I refer to that, that's the relatively stable continental interior. So we're not having big mountain building events going on there, but you can have some, you know, very broad arches or domes or basins forming. Where the majority of the tectonic activity is, it's in the orogenic belts. And this is where we have lots of metamorphism and deformation and volcanic activity and earthquakes and all that kind of stuff. So just remember, craton is pretty stable. Orogenic belts are where we have our major tectonic activity. All right, now on those cratons, we're going to start seeing what are called cratonic sequences. Earth's Phanerozoic history is marked by a lot of eustatic sea level rises and falls. And when we say eustatic sea level, remember that's global sea level. So the sea level all over the planet is rising and falling. And these sea level rises and falls create these things we call the unconformity bounded sequences. Unconformity bounded sequences are these major units of rock that have a usually very, very widespread unconformity both at the base of them and at the top of them. Unconformities, of course, being caused by periods of major erosion. And major periods of erosion occur because the land is above sea level. So what you see with these cratonic sequences is you see sea level rising, and you get sediments getting deposited on an erosional surface, and then sea level falls, the surface is exposed, and erosion can happen again. And so that's why you have an erosional surface at the bottom, then a major, major stack of sediments, and then an erosional surface at the top. There are six Phanerozoic cratonic sequences. So there's six sequences where sea level rose, deposited massive sediments, and then fell again. And we begin with the Sauk, then the Tippecanoe, then the Kaskaskia, the Absaroka, the Zuni, and the Tejas. And as we walk through geologic history, we're going to take a look at what happened in each and every one of those. Now, what causes a major global sea level change? Well, that's the rate of seafloor spreading. When it happens at a faster rate, it displaces that seawater and pushes it basically onto the continents. This is a very weird diagram, but it really shows a lot of information, and so I want to make sure that you guys understand what we're looking at in this diagram. So over here, these are the time periods, right? Cambrian, Ordovician, Silurian, Devonian, and so on. This is the west coast of North America, and these are the orogenies, the mountain building events on the west coast. This is the east coast of North America, and again, these are the orogenies on the east coast. Now, what this is showing in brown is basically land. So when we have here, we're getting less and less of the brown, that's telling us sea level is rising. So here's that Sauk cratonic sequence, right? The Sauk transgression, where sea level is rising and covering land, and then it regresses. And then we have the Tippecanoe transgression, and then it regresses. And that's what we're looking at in each one of these. So let's look at, to begin with, that Sauk transgression. The Sauk transgression begins in the Cambrian, and the craton prior to this was subaerial. It was above sea level for a very long time. For at least 500 million years, this craton was above sea level. That means we've had a lot of weathering and erosion happening to those rocks exposed at the surface. In addition to that, at this point in time, there's no land plants like holding soil or something into place. So the land surface was likely covered with basically just this sandy regolith. There is probably just sand covering everything because this was the result of that half a billion years of weathering and erosion. There is also probably a lot of aeolian activity. Remember, aeolian means wind. And right, if we don't have plants holding stuff in place, any winds are going to easily be able to blow around this loose, sandy material that's covering Earth's surface. So in the Sauk transgression, the seas start to rise, and at their highest, they cover most of North America except an area called the Transcontinental Arch. Transcontinental Arch is kind of in the middle part of the craton. And so that's what we're seeing right here. We have the Cambrian, we have the Sauk transgression, sea levels rising, and yeah, there are a few little falls in between, but overall, the sea level was rising and covering the majority of North America. The initial sediments in the Cambrian, so the ones that we first see as these sea levels rise, are usually clean, mature sandstones. So mature and clean meaning not a whole lot of silt and clay and mud, and mature referring to the fact that they're very quartz rich, very nicely rounded, and that's because we had half a billion years where this stuff was just kind of being chemically and mechanically weathered, and so we're left pretty much with a lot of quartz, right, because that can withstand that weathering. Now, as the sea levels continue to rise and the water level gets deeper, we start seeing carbonates. Remember, carbonates are limestones and dolostones. So during the Ordovician, when the sea level was at its highest and we have our the deepest water, we get limestones being much more dominant. Now, the ocean covering North America was less than about 200 meters deep. In fact, in many places, it was likely only tens of meters deep. So unfortunately, I'm not able to take you this semester on the Hill Country field trip. And if we would have been able to go on that field trip, we would have gone and seen some of these limestones that cover Texas. And some of the limestones are from different cratonic sequences, but in Texas, the water probably wasn't that deep. It was probably kind of at these tens of meters deep in areas. Now, why we get a lot of limestones is, first of all, there's not a lot of land exposed to create clastic sediment to wash into the seas. And if we're not getting clastic sediment, no sandstones. Also, we had warm, clear water. North America was sitting at the equator at this time. So these oceans, I mean, these would have been like awesome oceans to go snorkeling or scuba diving in, because they would have been very clear, they would have been warm, it would be like, you know, hanging out in the Caribbean is basically what we would have had. And so in these nice, warm, clear oceans, calcareous algae flourished. Calcareous refers to it secretes calcite or some sort of carbonate. And this algae was just really happy living in these warm, clear oceans. And of course, if it secretes calcite, when it dies and sinks to the bottom of the sea, you're going to start getting carbonate rocks accumulating. So that's why we get a lot of carbonates in the Ordovician. Now, in the early Ordovician, so this transgression happened in the Cambrian, we get to the early Ordovician, and then it starts regressing, and we get this regression in the early Ordovician. So, at the Salk transgression, what we would have had, we have, this is the land exposed, that's going to be in tan, this is the transcontinental arch. Light blue is shallow water, and darker blue is deeper water. So you can see really much of what we have today would be covered by these shallow ocean waters. This white line right here, that's the equator. The Salk transgression regressed, right? The water level dropped. And so then we have the continent exposed again for lots of weathering and erosion to occur. And then in the middle Ordovician to the Silurian, we start getting our next transgression, so our next sea level rise. And this is called the Tippecanoe transgression. So we had the Salk, and then it regressed in this early Ordovician, and now we have the Tippecanoe transgression creeping onto the Craton once again. Now, the base of the Tippecanoe transgression is marked by a very special sandstone called the St. Peter sandstone. St. Peter sandstone can be found in many parts of the central part of the United States. So we could be looking at it in parts of like Missouri, and I think Iowa has some of this, but anyway, central part of the US. And we consider this an ultra-mature sandstone. Ultra-mature because the little sand grains are ridiculously well-rounded, and the sandstone is pure quartz. I mean, you have to like really, really go looking to find anything that's not quartz in there. Like I said, this marks the base of the transgression. So why do we have this ultra-mature sandstone at the base of the transgression? Well, we have that because we, first of all, in the salt transgression, already had mature sandstones. Then the sea's regress exposed this stuff at the surface again, and now they're getting recycled once more. So anything that hadn't broken down already, any of those unstable minerals, break down now, and we're simply left with that well-rounded, pure quartz. The seas at this time, they get higher than the Salk transgression, so we have even more of the craton covered underwater. And lots of limestones get deposited on top of that basal sandstone. So we have that sandstone, and then as the water level rises, we start getting lots of limestones. Now today, many of them are dolostones. Limestone under certain circumstances will convert, it will change to dolostone. And so that's why in the Ordovician, lots of limestones and dolostones on top of your sandstone. Now, in some areas, the sea level rose so much that we get even deeper waters. And in these even deeper waters, we tend to have black graptolitic shale. When you did the fossil lab, there was this thin black rock that had the little, it looked like pencil scratches on it. That's the graptolitic shale. And like I said, in some areas where the water was deep enough, that's what we end up getting. Now, another important thing that happens in the Tippecanoe transgression in the Middle Ordovician is we start getting the Michigan Basin forming. So what we're seeing on land now, notice more of the continent is covered by that shallow water. And again, tan is land. Now, water that's like this color is a little bit deeper than the lighter blue. So lighter blue is really shallow, a little bit darker blue is a little bit deeper, and the really deep oceans is in the darkest blue. So we see it's getting a little bit darker here because that's that Michigan Basin starting to develop. And the Michigan Basin is something we call a reef fringed basin, meaning around the edges of the basin, we have reefs growing. And in that area, we also had arid conditions at the time. And this results in a lot of evaporation of the seawater. So rocks in the Michigan Basin include a lot of evaporites. We get a lot of gypsum and we get a lot of rock salt that has formed there. In fact, underneath the city of Detroit is a very large salt mine called the Detroit Salt Mine. So because we had these reefs fringing the Michigan Basin, this becomes what we call a barred basin. And this helps those extensive evaporites to form. So we have arid conditions leading to a lot of evaporation, but when we have a barrier like a reef that limits the circulation between the water of the basin and the water of the open ocean. And since we were in an arid environment, we have a lot of evaporation there. And this allows the waters in that basin to become oversaturated, basically, in salt. And you're gonna have some very dense brine, very dense, very salty water in the base of that basin. And from that, you're gonna start getting this salt precipitating. And if we did not have this barrier, this bar, or in this case, a reef, preventing this circulation with the open ocean, we wouldn't have quite as many evaporites forming there. We'll see barred basins develop in other places later on in geologic history. In fact, the Mediterranean, there are extensive salt deposits under the Mediterranean Sea because a very similar thing has happened there in much more recent geologic history. All right, now, North America has, we have the west coast of North America, and this geologists call the Cordillera. So if you ever hear a geologist say something like, I'm looking at the Cordillera, they're referring to western North America from the Rockies to the Pacific coast. And in the early Paleozoic, that Cordilleran area looked nothing like it does today. It was very flat and it was below sea level. And so you wouldn't have big mountain ranges there or anything. It would just basically be kind of these shallow seas. And from the Precambrian to the Cambrian, we have a passive margin. So there's no tectonic activity going on over there. And the rocks we have accumulating there are going to be sandstone, they're going to be shale, they're going to be limestones, kind of your typical shallow ocean sediments accumulating on this passive margin. And in fact, there are some great fossil localities from this time. One of them is called the Burgess Shale, and we will be going over the Burgess Shale in a few lectures from now when we look at Paleozoic life. Now, that's what the early Paleozoic ended up looking like, basically from the Precambrian to the Cambrian. This changes as we progress into the Silurian, or the Ordovician and Silurian. And in the next video, we're going to see how the Cordillera changes.